worship right now. There's deliverance coming to you as you worship. Worthy is the Lamb. Lord, you're my everything. As you just lift up your hands and surrender your life and surrender your heart and say, God, I love you and I need you. Cancer is leaving your body right now. Addictions and behaviors, generational curses are being broken right now. I come against every demonic spirit and I cause it in the name of Jesus to be driven far from your life. He's everything. Right now, just say to God, you're everything. There's no room for the devil to occupy your life if God is everything. If you say, God, I make you everything, I'm not playing games. I don't want to just have a Sunday God. I want a Monday God and a Tuesday God and a Wednesday God and a Thursday God. God, you're everything. I'm tired of the struggle. I'm tired of trying to do life on my own. I'm tired of the depression. I'm tired of these things that I'm carrying. I'm tired of the emptiness and the void. God, you're everything. And just with that one simple worship, that one simple prayer, I promise you right now, every demonic spirit is being driven from your life in the name of Jesus Christ, because it cannot stay. Darkness cannot live where there is light. I want you to get up and call the toll-free number. There are people standing by right now. They want to pray for you. They want to come and covenant. If two, just two, agree as touching anything, all things are possible. We want to come in agreement, and I thank God for TBN Partners, for Paul and Jane Crouch, for all of those who allow the gospel to go forth. Because of that, because of the gospel of Jesus Christ going forth, people are being delivered right now. They're being healed right now. They're being set free. They're being saved right now. There's an anointing. Chris is about to just ride in this resident anointing. This young man that has been raised up for such a time as this. He pastors in Norfolk, Virginia, the Way of the Cross, one of the greatest churches, but greater than that, one of the great, and it's not greater than that, but he's one of the greatest voices. The first time I saw him minister, it was just, I could see 20, 30 years in the future. This is a world changer. This is a man that's been raised up to bring in. This is, and I say this with great humility, but I remember, and I knew Bishop Jakes 25, 30 years ago in West Virginia. Chris, your days have not been seen yet, but God's getting ready to put you up on a platform that the world will know Chris Hines, but you will know God in a greater way. And because he's everything, it's not going to be about ministry. It's going to be about relationship. And out of that relationship and who God is to you, many are going to feast at the table that the Lord is going to spread. I want you just to continue to minister and tell us what God's doing and what you feel in your spirit right now.
Well, Pastor Paula, before I say that, I just want to thank you for this opportunity and this wonderful network. And I just appreciate the anointing that is just so fresh, not just in this room, but all over the country. God is doing a new thing.
Yeah.
And I am just excited about it. When you talk about what God is saying in this hour and the move of God, I feel, and I've sensed that I've been able to travel this year, there is a great frustration. And the frustration that is in the earth, I believe, is because there are so many ministers specifically and people of God in the body of Christ that are just out of place. They are not functioning in their assignment.
Okay.
In other words, they've seen things work for other people and they're trying to work a system rather than work what God has given them. And as a consequence, originality has suffered in the body of Christ, and we've cloned more than created.
Yeah.
I think about Nehemiah chapter 3, but even before chapter 3, the Bible says that he was a cupbearer. And the interesting thing about Nehemiah was the reason why he was drawn to the wall was because he understood vulnerability. He was a cupbearer. He was susceptible to dying at any moment. In other words, it was his assignment to keep the king alive.
Right.
And so because he understood purpose and the fact that purpose cannot die, purpose cannot be vulnerable, he was drawn to Jerusalem where everything was happening. And the Bible says that he saw an assignment, so he decided it was his job to rebuild, not build, but rebuild the walls. The first 23 verses in chapter 3, all you see is next.
Yeah.
Next, 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 next. They start building, and next to them, somebody else is already building. And that's what most people don't understand. God doesn't want us to be concerned about next. Worry about now. And let God handle the next. I can't tell you how many leaps of faith we've made in our ministry without having any clue how God was going to work out tomorrow.
Yeah.
We just knew what he wanted us to do today. And as a consequence, when you get to verse 23, it shifts from saying next, and then it says beyond.
Yeah.
It says next to the wall, next to the wall, next to the wall. Then it says beyond the wall. And beyond, they literally shift where they work. And God takes them from just working and concentrating on next, moves them to beyond. Beyond is front. It's when God shows your enemies what he's been doing in the background.
Come on.
And that's where God is taking us. He's taking us to a place where God is getting ready to reveal in the earth those who have dwelt in the secret place of the Most High. And he's getting ready to allow us to abide in the shadows of the Almighty. Not only does it say that it moves from next to beyond, then it shifts in verse 28. It says above the wall.
Right.
Now, this is an interesting paradigm now, because God has already shown your enemies where you're going, but you're not there yet. He takes them to above because there's a season in your ministry, in your life, where heaven honors what you've been doing on the earth.
Come on.
And I believe that as we close out this year, heaven is getting ready to honor those, not who are necessarily popular, but those who have sacrificed and were faithful over a few things. That preacher who's been preaching and nobody would give him a call and nobody would help him with his ministry, but he has a heart for people, not a heart to fleece people, but a heart to really love people. Then the last verse in chapter 3, verse 30, he goes from next, he goes from beyond, he goes from above, then he says between the
right.
walls. And the interesting thing about that is that most people think once heaven is on your side, you don't have any more issues. But you can testify more than anybody that there's some in-between seasons.
There's some issues still.
There's some stuff in the middle that the enemy comes in.
Right.
But what I love about God is he said if we have enough faith to speak it on the earth, he would honor it in heaven. And if we loose it on earth, then he would loose it in heaven. And I believe that's what God is doing for so many people in this hour. He's releasing the spirit of fear. We can't worry about what's not happening and what's not coming in. All we can do is take the leap of faith. It doesn't have to rain to build an ark. We've got to move out on faith and have the kind of now faith that becomes the substance that moves and guides what God is doing in our lives.
Chris, here's what I hear you saying, that God's raising up a remnant, a remnant that had not been released yet, a remnant of people that are being raised up for such a time as this. A remnant is the end of the bold. It's what's left over. It literally means a survivor. And anytime God positions a people for purpose to do something great, greatness is always released from a remnant. And so I believe there are people that have been in hiding, but you better get ready because you're not going to stay hidden. God is lifting you up. And it's not man that's going to promote you. It's the hand of God. And when God lifts you up, man cannot set you down. Man doesn't have to like you for God to endorse you. Man doesn't have to vote you in or be for God to say, I'm with you. And you said they've taken off Saul's armor and they're wearing their own.
That's right.
They said, I can't put on another man's armor.
Absolutely.
And here was the real, here's what qualifies the remnant. Beside making it through and surviving some things that other people quit in, Nehemiah was this is the power in, because foundation and essentially what made him be the builder of everything is he asked the right questions. He said, how are God's people and how is God's place?
Right.
It revealed his heart. Here's who's getting ready to come stand on the stage. People who care about God's people and people who care about God's place.
Mm-hmm.
And God said there's been a shaking so that everything that can be shaken will be shaken. And what I'm going to bring to the forefront are people who care about what I care about.
Absolutely.
And God cares about his people and God cares about his place. And he's raising up a remnant in the earth that's getting ready to be released. You're part of that remnant. You're part of one of the mighty men that are coming forth to declare what thus saith the Lord, to be that clarion call, to release into the earth what God Amen. Is doing and what God's saying. And people are going to stand back and they're saying, how can he say this? Where is this coming from? They'll say, but he's only this age or he's done this, but you're what I call an old soul. You have the revelation of the Lord and God is going to speak through you and speak in you. And that's what I see happening in this season.
And the interesting thing about that is that anytime God uses a man, he doesn't have the benefit of being artificial.
Mm.
We always have a responsibility to ourselves to remain authentic. Because the minute you walk out of yourself, you walk out of your purpose, you walk out of your place, and people are not drawn to who you think you are. people are drawn to who you know you are. And I know that what God is doing in this hour is he's replacing those who think that they're in position or in place. And he's putting those who know who they are and who have known who they are. And the way you know who you are is when you've been through hell, when you've been through high waters, when you've been through storms, when you've been through things that other people couldn't handle, and you look back over your life and you say, it almost broke me, it almost took me down, but thank God I didn't just survive it, but I more than overcame it. And when you learn that that is what made you, it becomes a part of who you are. You can't help but make it. You can't help but be successful. You can't help but move in levels of faith that is just uncommon to many people.
Okay, let's bring it down to where people are living, because there are some people that are gonna have a real difficult time living authentic to themselves. They're two things that stand out as you're talking to me. Number one, someone will say, how do you go through so much hell when you've lived this life? But this generation has an accelerated destiny. This Absolutely. Generation faces in a decade what generations in the past did not face in a century. They're facing rapidly. They're having to deal with things. The world has never been in this place. So I believe that God has equipped you through an experience, through revelation, through different means, through different methods, through different modes. But as you come forth, how do you, Chris, as a young man, live authentic and not be the lemming? How do you break the mold? Because I believe that you're the ones setting the mold. I believe you're the ones creating culture. You're the ones that are the prototype to come forth and pioneer. Because old, and when I say old school, what I'm saying is not the foundations of our faith as far as Absolutely. What we believe. Our absolute truths are our absolute truths. But the way we've done things in the past is not working for today. Absolutely. And so God's saying, how, Chris, do you as a pastor find your authentic purpose in the earth?
Well, one of the most important things in my life is relationship. And I am surrounded by great men of God and my pastor who not just speaks into my life and encourages me, but helps me to see exactly things that I wouldn't be able to see now. My wife, she helps me because we're able to have a relationship where I can be myself. And in that, it brings me to a place, and this is something that's not really popular now, but what has kept me and what keeps me and what moves me is prayer. Seeking God in the most difficult times of your life, seeking him when you don't feel like it. Seeking him when you have so much going on and you should be doing this and should be doing that, but understanding that God's voice is what got me here and God's voice is what's going to keep me here. And having a consistent prayer life is what gives you the ability to hear God when everything is so loud. And it gives you the confidence to just be yourself. That if I don't fit into the mold of what has been done before, that's fine.
Right.
I've got to be who I am. I can't do what other guys have done. They've done a wonderful job of laying wonderful foundations. But in this season, we're dealing with people who didn't come from a church.
Right.
We're dealing with people who, the interesting thing about this generation is in generations past, when people felt like they were going to get themselves together and fix their life, church was pretty much the only option. People have options now. Yeah. They're going to all different types of sources and things. And as a consequence, the church in so many ways has sometimes failed people because we've chosen to try to correct them rather than love them. And so sometimes the church is the last place that people want to go. And because, like I said earlier, originality is so stifled in the body of Christ that when someone is original and sees some success, in most cases, it's not the people in the world that fight them, but it's other ministries and other pastors and other preachers that are killing other pastors and other preachers. And so when you have that authentic prayer life, where you can seek God and you know what he's saying to you, you can have confidence that regardless of what is going on, I know what God said and I can stand on what God said. And as long as I stay in this place, he didn't say it would be perfect, but he said he would have my back.
Come on, Chris, that's the truth. It starts with that foundation, going back to our basics, seeking the Lord, prioritizing his presence. And I know your story, but for the benefit of the person that doesn't know, who is Chris Hines? Being authentic to yourself, you stepped into a ministry that was established. Right. Your grandfather had pastored, so that's often not an easy thing to do. Tell me how you made that transition to be authentic, because it's easier to start from a new beginning. Absolutely. I mean, it's easier to create almost out of nothing sometimes than it is to step into the shoes of someone who is established, because the hardest thing to change is a mindset.
Absolutely.
The hardest thing to change.
It's interesting. I was a musician and I played for my grandfather. And at the age of 22, after having had a child as a teenager, dropped out of school, went back to school, got my GED, went and got a college degree. At 22 years old, my grandfather looked at me and said he felt that it was time for me to start shifting into ministry. Little would I know that not even a year from that date, he just passed away. On his deathbed, he asked me, would I take over his ministry? And to be completely honest with you, I said, yes, I'll do it. But I was thinking in the back of my mind, yeah, for now. But I promise you, somebody else is going to take this. And I'll never forget, it was Easter Sunday of 2006, was my first Sunday as pastor. The first message that I preached was on the Easter Sunday. The first funeral I had ever done was his. And the first 2 years of our ministry tripled in size. It was heaven on earth. I said to myself, if preaching is this easy, I should have did this a long time ago. But I'll never forget, after 2 years of success, I went through three church splits. And it took my ministry to a place where if I was not built upon the right stuff, I would not have survived. And interestingly enough, to be completely honest with you, I didn't know I was built with the right stuff. Yeah. It took hell to teach me who I was. It took me having to lose everything to teach me who I was. I mean, in that season, everything that could have possibly happened, happened. My daughter almost passed away. She was gravely ill. We just went through so many transitions in our life and in our family. And just when I felt like giving up, what blessed my life was I never stopped preaching. Mm-hmm. When I realized that before the world was framed, God had anointed my mouth to preach. And as long as I stay in my assignment,
yes,
then whatever came down, it's going to come back up. I don't even know who that word is for, but
speak
that's somebody's
them.
Word that you're watching us right now and you're saying to yourself, I want to give up. I want to throw in the towel. I want to leave my family. I want to walk away from everything. I want to encourage you. Don't let the enemy stop you from being who you are. God knew all of who you would be. He knew all of the hell that you would go through before he called you. And the good news is that he didn't consult with your enemies before he gave you a license. And this is your season to walk in your purpose like never before. Don't worry about the money. Don't worry about the platforms. Don't worry about the position. Stay in purpose. And if you stay in purpose, I promise you, he will give it back to you. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over. And men, somebody somewhere has a checkbook. Lord, I wish I had a church. Somebody somewhere with a checkbook is waiting to write you a check to write off whatever it is that you need done. So I want to encourage somebody today that I am here just because I stayed in my purpose. And because I stayed in my purpose, relationships begin to form. And God began to send people like you into my life. And people all over the country begin to pour in me and just say, it's not supposed to be easy. Who said that it was supposed to be easy? But it's supposed to be purposeful. And when you understand who you are, God is going to take you to where eyes have not seen and where ears have not heard. Is it all right if I pray? I just feel led to pray for someone. Father, in the name of Jesus, I speak into the life of some young man, some young woman right now who's been struggling with her identity. He's been struggling with who he is. He has an addiction. He's been dealing with generational spirits and curses. and the enemy has done everything he could to try to take him out. But I'm so glad that after all the hell that we have been through, we still have joy. Father, I thank you because what's to come is better than what's been. I thank you for the favor of the Lord that's falling on that person right now. And we speak it into their life. And the blessing of the Lord maketh rich and addeth no sorrow. And we declare and decree and proclaim that it is so and that it is done in Jesus' name. Somebody ought to say amen.
Amen. Amen. To you, he's saying, get back in the game. Stop standing on the sideline. You're not called to be a spectator. You're called to be a participator. But if you only knew what I've gone through, get back up. Get in your purpose. Don't give up. Stand up. God has purpose. Listen, no matter what, if you will stay in your assignment, and Chris said it so well, no matter who believes in you or doesn't believe in you, no matter what went right or what went wrong, if you stand there and stay, my spiritual father taught me this. He said, Paula, when I was going through the most difficult time of my life, Bishop Jake said, Paula, just stand. He said, because just like the earth is rotating around the sun, he said, it's going to change for you. And he said, as long as you don't stop standing, everything will shift in your life.
That's right.
It's about to shift for you. You're entering in a new season. God is turning it around. Stay in your lane of assignment. Stay in your purpose because God is for you. And if God be for you, who can be against you? You better.